Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to day two of GST Colloquium, four dimensions of four-year journey. So yesterday we have our first session, which was recap to precap, in which we got a macro perspective of where GST is headed. And for sure, it is not turning out to be a good and simple tax. We got a lot of positive feedback from both the participants as well as the panelists in terms of the format of the discussions and the quality of the topics which we took. So here we are So if anyone of you has missed out attending yesterday's session, it's available on YouTube on our Nitya Tax Associates channel. You can watch that. So all these sessions will be available there. And commence our session two today, which is burning issues on taxability. And we are again with a distinguished set of panelists. So in today's session, we will be discussing various issues relating to taxability and reverse charge, starting from classification and rate issues, cross charge versus ISD, disputes relating to discounts and incentives, place of supply issues, reverse charge issues, employee recoveries, liquidated damages. So we have a full packed agenda for today. And in even yesterday's session, some of the points which were emanating was that the GST law is not properly drafted, starting from the point that there is no definition of supply. It's an inclusive definition. And secondly, the rulings, advanced rulings like Columbia Asia, et cetera, have upset the whole tax structure. Adding to that, we don't have a definition of service. So service is defined as anything other than goods. So lot of gray areas continue to be in GST regime as far as taxability aspect is concerned. And with this, we start today's session. And to introduce our panelists, we have Mr. H.P. Gupta, who is finance head, Hero Motocorp. We have Mr. Sudhir Goyal, who is CFO of Amber Enterprises India. We have Mr. Rahul Verma, who is tax head of Cipla. And we have Mr. Ravi Gupta, who is a general manager indirect taxation of Dharampal Satyapal. So with this, I hand over session to our Deepak Suneja, who will be moderating this session. So over to you, Deepak.
Thanks, Puneet. Thanks everyone for joining today. I think we have a great pool of knowledge with different panelists from different industries joining us. Just a disclaimer before we start that all the discussions today would be industry generic and not specific to any company. So we start with a very interesting issue. And I think the first thing when we start with GST or a taxpayer thinks about is what would be the rate of tax on his product? And under GST, if you see, they have introduced multiple tax rates. So we have a tax rate of 5%, Parul, you can proceed. So we have a tax rate of 0%, 5%, 12%, 18%, 28%. All these different tax rates are there. These tax rates raise an issue of classification as well as GST rate. So if you see, there have been several disputes, be it of Malabar Parathas, be it of sanitizers, be it on automotive components, what would be the GST rate on these products? Then you see that they have been advanced rulings which have been there, which have been mostly been pro-revenues. And recently, the government also introduced a six-digit HSN, which effectively is eight-digit for taxpayers. And who knows that tomorrow they bring in eight-digit different GST rates for at an eight-digit level, as it happens in customs. So in this background, we also conducted a poll asking the audience whether they fear the GST rate disputes in coming future. And the poll result showed that almost 78% of them fear that today or tomorrow the GST department may come and say that the goods that they are supplying or the services that they are supplying is not the correct GST rate which they are charging. And there are then disputes of composite supply and everything. So in this background, we move towards the first session and to our first panelist. So Mr. Gupta, we'll start with you. In your view, is there a doubt in industry's mind vis-a-vis the classification that they're adopting, or are they more or less comfortable in what they're adopting?
Yeah, so Deepak, I think it's a very, burning issue of the industry. We all know that it is almost 4 years since GST was rolled out. And in some of the cases, industries is still, feeling the heat. Sometimes there is a very thin line between the two classifications. So I would say that in 97 to 98% of the cases, we do not see any challenge, or maybe different type of industry. But there are cases where there is a very thin line whether to go here and there. And to my mind, these issues are not the new issues. I think when we go in the S2I era, in the excise regime, I think initially we saw that there was a lot of, issues around the classifications. And maybe in 2001, after that, when the simplification was done, the things was, toned down. Over what is my belief is that definitely department will raise the issues and some of the industries will definitely be trapped and they will be having some tough time in the future. Is important that we need to be very meticulous while choosing the classification. That's number one. Secondly, gradually, I think with the passage of time, industry and department both will work together. And maybe what personally I believe, feel that, over a period of time, things will come down and will settle gradually. But yeah, overall, this is an issue. And definitely industry will face some, issues, maybe which can be raised by the department where, particularly where that there are two different rate tax structure. If the tax structure is same, it does not matter. I mean, which classification you choose.
Right.
But yeah, it will have some impact.
And Deepak, just to add to what Mr. Gupta is saying, that pre-GST, as far as excise was concerned, even though different classifications were there, but rates were same, so it was actually immaterial. Only for VAT, we had description-based taxation. And in GST, apart from these five rates, I think what government has... done an error is that within same set of products also, the rates are varying. So like you gave example of Malabar Paratha. So just to illustrate, so for a client, we handled this matter in advanced ruling and we were able to prove to advanced ruling authority that same product can attract 0% also, 5% also, and 18% also. So that much variance in same set of products was there. And secondly, even though the disputes may be less, but they are capable of derailing the whole business. That suppose a taxpayer is charging 18% and tomorrow it turns out to be 28%. So the department will always make a demand for the past as well. In yesterday's session, we also discussed that the advance ruling mechanism is totally pro-revenue. So there's no way in which a taxpayer can get a certainty except that it does his own correct assessment and adopt it. Yeah, so I fully agree with Mr. Gupta that this is likely to be a big issue in times to come.
Right. So Sudhirji, what is your view? In your industry also, are the taxpayers facing a similar issue or it is better settled there?
No, yes, as rightly said by Mr. Gupta, there is a big issue in the classification of various goods under HSN. And we also face that same similar challenge, not because of taxes, tax rates only, but in terms of the internal controls as well. Because similar product is being supplied by one vendor in a different HSN code and a different vendor in a different HSN code. Right. That is also making things very complex to control the things. So I think it's a big challenge and we should bring down to these four rates into at least minimum two rates. Now government is having a lot of database in the last 4 years that which products they are getting how much GST and they can easily derive the neutral rate which will ease the life of the various assesses and that will not impact the companies to identify which SSN code they need to fall on. So right. I totally agree with that, that it should be like reduced to at least two rates in the coming days and ultimately to a one single rate.
Right. So I will be taking a cue of combination of rates. But before that, I think there's also a need to refer to a very important judgment which the Supreme Court pronounced recently. That was the Westinghouse case. So in Westinghouse case, what they said is, and what would be relevant for both Mr. Gupta's industry and your industry being railways. So they held that the parts of railways or automobiles, if they are designed specifically for that product, then it would get classified as parts of railways or parts of automobiles. And there's a variance in rates of these products vis-a-vis the general rate. So if the general rate is 18%, if it is a part of automobile, it would attract 28% rate. If it is a part of railways, it would attract 12% rate. So there's a variance there. So I'll ask Mr. Gupta here to highlight that, what do you think is the impact of Westinghouse on the industry, overall auto industry?
Yeah, I think Deepak, again, equally very important issue. So far, I would say, since the judgment has been announced, there are, supply chain partners, those who have been raising this issue, that they are getting the notices from the department. To an OEM, it does not matter because it is revenue neutral kind of a thing. But I think it has got long-term ramifications. Yeah. So let me try to give one example. Anything and everything which is fitted in one vehicle, yeah, should be at the rate which is the rate of the finished goods. Yeah. The basic overall logic and rationale of HSN code, which is compatible and which is kind of a, I would say, has been copied, which is being followed globally. Yeah. The Custom Tariff Act and other things, the HSN code, the everything. I think this judgment is going to defeat everything. I think it is going to cause a lot of challenges. I mean, the amount of challenges we feel, I think will be out of control of everyone. And then how the whole mechanism of OEM versus the spare parts or after sales market would be handled, will there be different ways? Like for example, bearing, if it is bearing is being used in aeroplane, they will be carrying a different rate. If it is being used in 250cc vehicle, it will be different rate. Or if it is being used 350cc vehicle, it will be having a different rate. So all those, challenges will pop up. I think this is definitely, there are different views that revenue may file a review petition, which may or may not be, successful, as we know the history of review petitions. But I personally believe that ministry will definitely come up with some clarification on this issue, because this has been, this could be a kind of a field problem more than to the industry. And I think that the challenges, the amount of issues which will get, popped up, and the way, particularly during these days of COVID, when industry sentiments are already on the beaten side, the consumer behavior is not that great. We have eroded the customer from the market because of the buying power of the customer has come down. I personally believe that we as a professional, or including the professional firms, should take this matter very, rigorously with the department and persuade it to bring some clarification on this issue, so as to industry get some, solace on the front that it is being done. But yeah, given the Supreme Court, it is a Supreme Court decision. It is from the apex body of the country. It has got no solution now. Presently, I see a lot of, clouds around. But yeah, over a period of time, as we have seen in past, like the Fiat judgment and many more judgment, things have resolved. So I hope that GST Council should, or maybe the coming budget should address this issue. That is what I am expecting. Otherwise, it is going to be a very painful journey for all of us for next 2-3 years.
Very frankly, I think a lot of the audience would be having this anxiety, and your words would have given some comfort. And I think even the poll percentage, around 10-20% would be people who are affected by this Westinghouse and now are fearing that there would be a dispute and challenge in future. So thank you, sir, for this clarity.
No, but Deepak, there is other side also. There are people who are getting benefited also out of this Westinghouse ruling.
Right. And
so they want
easy for this.
So as rightly said by Mr. Gupta, that there could be a big challenge for various industries because they will be like deciding that which tax they need to adopt. And as Puneet has said, that it is beneficial for some of the industries because goods earlier it was falling under the specific HSN code for a specific product, but now with this judgment, it will go in the ultimate utilization, ultimate product of the product in which it is going to be used. So yes, we are beneficiaries, or maybe like a railway industry will be beneficiary of this, because under railway, railway falls under the 12% category, whereas the product falls under might be 18 or might be 28% category. But on an overall basis, that it should be like, there should be a proper clarity, should be come out by the GST department, that how the assessee should deal with these kind of a situations. And this is also related to the first question where we have a multiple GST rates. So if those GST rates can bring down to single GST rate, these all like ambiguity in the HSN code and the GST rates will be eliminated. So I hope that government should think over it and will bring down the rates to a single rate, which was the erstwhile like intention of the government. But due to various challenges, they couldn't able to do that. So I believe that that first question solves all these problems of HSN code and all these things.
So on this related point only, Sudhiji, on combination of rates, I'd like to ask a question from Rahul, because he is presently facing a case wherein different products fall under different category. So Rahul, there was a news recently wherein the government proposed to merge 12% and 18% rate. So my question is industry welcoming the step of merging the rates, or do you foresee that there may be challenges in that also, that let us say an agricultural implement goes from 12% to let us say 15%, they'll raise a hue and cry, while the product wherein there's a reduction of rate, they'll happily celebrate. So what do you think, what the industry expectation is? Collaboration of these rates and making it one, or they would like to continue with multiple rates only?
Actually, you know, in pharma, it's always a little complicated, because the thing is, it's not just, you know, the GST council, but there is also interplay of, you know, the price regulatory authority for pharmaceutical products, NPPA, which also has to play a role. So like, you know, when we're talking of the rates, the only rate which we don't like to have in, you know, in the tariff is just 0%. Because when it comes to 0%, you know, there's a different embargo from coming from NPPA, and a different embargo coming from, say, GST side. Like recently, the rate was reduced to 0% for, you know, two medicines. One is Actemra, one is Amphotericin for black fungus. So in both the cases, rate were reduced from 5 to 0, and, you know, eventually the manufacturer has to shed out all the input credits which are lying there. And, you know, because NPPA didn't allow to, you know, take even the credit for the inputs which are already built in the product. But having said so, you know, while that being a concern, and you know, the Madam Finance Minister always told when the request went for, you know, reducing the rate of tax on vaccine, she didn't, you know, took it to zero, because she knew it's going to, you know, have some impact on the cost structure of the pharma company. Hmm. But having said so, you know, if you know, having a single rate or, you know, two band rate would be good, because the thing is, there are, you know, medicine which are more of a, you know, say more of a lifestyle drugs, or, you know, they're, you know, medicine which are life-saving. Obviously, there is going to be, you know, two rates are always welcome. And right now, the most of the drugs are into 5% and 12%. And two maybe go 28%, like dermatology and stuff like that. So what we preferred is, you know, this 5%, 12%, at least that should be combined. At least we'll have one rate of, you know, 12%. And, you know, because going too low, like 5%, you know, altogether power products will actually, you know, burden the industry with input credit and, you know, the issues around, you know, liquidation of those credit. So, you know, it's always welcome to, you know, reduce the rate from 5, 12 and 18 to, you know, one rate of say 12%, if that could be, you know, feasible for the government. And I think similar representation has been made as well, because large part of the product is on 5 and 12. I think there's hardly anything on 18%. So we look forward to that change because, you know, you always, you know, tend to, you know, take a wrong step. Like in case of, you know, all these sanitizers, there's a lot of human cry because, you know, the, based on the chemical composition of those sanitizers, so they could be, you know, classified at 12% because they have some pharma component on there, which is used for, you know, internal use in hospitals and all that stuff like that. But with the COVID pandemic coming in, they are now used at home as well. So based on the use, there's a lot of dispute around whether, you know, that should be at 12 or 18. So now all, most of those products are brought to 18%. So an industry has to pay to catch up onto the, you know, past defaults. So this always welcome, we could have, you know, one rate, not 12 or 18 or 5, but, you know, just 12 for all those pharmaceutical products. So that's my submission.
Right. So good to know, Rahul, that while many of the taxpayers do anticipate a lot of disputes regarding classification, but industry is representing and supporting merging of rates. And I think that would be, as all the panelists, most of the panelists said, that that might be the future in reducing tax litigations in future in this respect. Right. So we move on to the next topic now. An equally interesting topic vis-a-vis the rate of classification is ISG and cross-charge. So vis-a-vis cross-charge and ISG, there have been, the main issue arises when there's a head office in one state and let us say factories, branch office and liaison office in other states. And there is a flow of services from head office to branch office or from branch office to head office vis-a-vis accounting support, administrative support, management support, all these supports. So the dispute mainly arises because of the Schedule 1 of the CGST Act, which says that if two units are located in different states, then any goods that is supplied, any service that is supplied is exigible to tax even without consideration. So they have also included the service element in the element of cross-charging or charging to tax when they are between two units. Meanwhile, correspondingly, there is Section 20 of the CGST Act, which contains ISG provisions. So there is a provision which states that if, let us say, a common service is received by a head office, it would be distributed to all the other units through an ISG mechanism. On top of it, there are advanced ruling which suggests that cross-charge and ISG are both mandatory. There's a circular which says that only cross, that they are optional. You can do either. So there's a lot of confusion which is there in the industry because of the circular advanced rulings coming, a different industry. Just one point before we move to our poll is that under the erstwhile law, there were rulings which stated that vis-a-vis an Indian branch office or an Indian head office and foreign branches, they were deemed to be separate entities. But the service tax, the tribunal has consistently stated that there is no supply between them when they support each other because it's actually a part of the business and not a service person. So on this part, we also took a poll of what does industry feel that in their business, if they have multiple units, should they be allocating through cost charge to ISG or which method should they follow? And quite frankly, this is the only poll till now if we have seen such a split vote. 48% say ISG, oh sorry, cross charge, 31% say ISG, and only 14% say both. So if you see, this clearly represents the confusion which is there in the mind of the viewers, that which method should they follow. And therefore, they'll be very interested now to know the panelists' view, some expert view on what should they be doing or what do they suggest. So I'll start now with Mr. Ravi Gupta. Mr. Ravi, you also, in your company also, you must be facing this issue that there's a head office and branches across different states. So what do you recommend to the viewers? What should they be doing? Cross-charge, ISG, both, which one would you suggest? Raviji, you are on mute.
Hi, Deepak. So, yes. Deepak, it is not only our company, it is the entire industry who is facing this issue.
Right.
And as you know, we are about to enter in fifth year of GST, and this issue is same as it was on the first day. Right. So, I think this is the most contentious and debated issue in the industry since the inception. And in the near future, we'll also see there will be no improvement or no decrease in these debates until unless CBIC will come with the more clarity on the issues, right? So from my experience or the company which I know, I can divide the companies into five buckets. As you rightly pointed out, that 48% of companies are using cross chart, somewhere 31% are using this ISD. So yes, I'm also of the same view. I can divide all this category into rather five categories, not in three categories. So there are companies who are using only cross chart. They are using cross chart as a substitute of ISD.
Mm-hmm.
Then there are a group of companies who are using only ISD. They are not using any cross chart. They are not adhering with this schedule one provision in respect of services to distinct person. Now, then there are a different set of companies who are using hybrid system of ISD and cross charge.
Mm-hmm.
ISD they are using for distributing third party services, and cross charge they are using for internal services.
Mm-hmm.
Right. On the basis of these three categories, there are two more categories. One categories are those set of companies who have started with cross charge and now gradually moving from cross charge to the hybrid system of ISD and cross charge. And again, there is another set of company who has initially started with ISD and cross charge or only ISD, and now they move completely on cross charge. So again, there is a confusion in the entire industry, and this confusion will, I don't see any end to this confusion until unless government will come up with more clarity on cross chart and cross chart, specifically cross chart as substitute of ISD, right? Because you just mentioned that there are some advanced ruling which refer this cross charge and ISD can coexist. So yes, this confusion will be there whether to go for cross charge, go with ISD, go with hybrid of cross ISD and cross chart. So this confusion will be there in the future.
But Raviji, as one suggestion, what would you give one suggestion to our viewers that what should they be doing? Cross charge, ISD, both?
Deepak, if you ask me, so I'm of the view that ISD is the traditional way of distributing head office credit to the unit or sales reports, etc., etc. Right. Moreover, ISD rules also specify that in what ratio credit has to be distributed, right? And this is the more settled procedure in the GST, also in the erstwhile Service Tax Act. However, if we go to cross charge, so I found only one circular that is also in respect of banking companies, which says that ITC, this common ITC of the head office, can be distributed to this other branches of same PAN, right? If I compare both ISD and cross chart, so I also already specified the benefit of ISD. So benefit of cross chart, which I see is that we don't have to maintain dual registration. In cross chart, in ISD, we have to maintain dual registration. So when we maintain dual registration, we have to give lot of training to the user departments, user service department. We have to give lot of trainings to vendor, which registration has to be used on which cases. So this kind of lot of training has to be provided in case of ISD. And moreover, what problem we are seeing in the current scenario is we are maintaining both ISD and cross chart both. So what problem we are seeing is that we have to come up with again ISD and cross charge reconciliation. So there may be set of invoices which vendor has raised in cross charge, whereas purchase order has been issued from the ISD registration. So on monthly or quarterly basis, we have to do a reconciliation between ISD and cross charge. So if given choice, I will definitely go with the cross charge. And again, parallelly, I would also request to CBIC to bring some clarity on cross charge, especially on the substitute of ISD, because this clarity is missing. And because of this clarity, there is a lot of confusion in the industry. Deepak.
So very valid points, Raviji, you have made. And the whole problem comes up is, again, we have no definition of supply from a cross-charge perspective as to if suppose Raviji, you sitting in the corporate office, you are supporting, say, indirect tax matters of a brand, say, located in Tamil Nadu. So whether it's a supplier or not. Secondly, you rightly pointed out that there was a need of ISD provision under pre-GST laws because there was no other manner of distribution of credit. But now law clearly provides this cross-charge thing. And industry has been representing this for long. And in 35th GST Council meeting, which happened on 21st June 2009, which is almost 2 years back, this issue was specifically discussed. The matter was referred to the law committee. If you go to GST Council site, the minutes and even a draft circular is there, which has not been issued till date. And I have read that draft circular number of times, including today also. You cannot make any head or tail out of it. Firstly, it says that ISD is required. Then it says there is no supply. Then it says common expenses. These things have to be cross-charged, etc. So there's an utter confusion on this. And in our polls, we have made four categories. Raviji has added two more variants also. Who started with ISD, now cross-charge. Who started with cross-charge, now ISD. So, and I think there can be two more options also. Who started with ISD, he's doing both now. Who started with cross-charge, he's again doing both now. So Raviji, your point is absolutely valid that the government should come out with clear clarifications. Otherwise, how these advanced rulings are coming out, it is creating a lot of confusion. But yeah, as the law stands today, in our view, ISD is not a mandatory requirement. Even though they have carried the concept, it was not actually required. Cross-charge should suffice. But yes, a clarification from GST Council and government side would rest all these disputes to end.
Right. So interesting thing pointed out that Puneet, 2 years it took, it has taken and probably will take more time for government to think what is to be done. And they expect the industry to do the right thing from day one.
Yeah.
So Sudhirji, you must also have faced similar issues in your industry. How have you tackled with that? Or how are the players tackling it with, in this case?
Same issue is being raised by, faced by us as well. Like earlier, we were starting using ISD because technically things are not established for the cross-charge in the initial days of the implementation of GST. So we started with ISD. Then there's a circular came up in 2018 that both are optional. Like Mr. Ravi Gupta has said. So we opted for the ISD because of the various reasons. And again, now this advanced ruling came up that we need to charge the cross-charge, and that too, this ruling will be retrospective. It will not be prospective, but retrospective. So whatever we have done in the past, it will create an issue. And definitely the department can come anytime for raising some demand or something like that. So in my view, like Mr. Ravi has said, there should be five options. But in my view, it should be completely optional on assessee. Whether they should charge, cross-charge, whether they should do ISD, whether they don't want to do anything. Because other than this, like on the goods, it should be cross-charge. On the services, it can be ISD. But what about the employee cost? How we will tackle this? And in case of a company who is dealing in the exempted goods, that is an additional burden on them.
True.
It will become an additional cost to those companies.
Right.
So in my view, it should be optional. Whatever company wants, whether they want ISD or cross-charge or they don't want to do anything. It should be completely optional. Right. Or even if they made cross-charge compulsory, then it should be only on the goods and the services received from the external sources.
Right.
Or within the company, services are provided to various branches. Those should not come under the ambit of the cross charge or the ISD as well.
Deepak, I fully agree with Sudhir ji. So if it is cross charge, so services to distinct persons should be excluded from cross charge. Cross charge, this cross charge, yes, schedule one. Only goods related provision should be there under schedule one. So if we continue with the, suppose if we taken this Columbia Asia ruling, so why they limited themselves to the salaries of the head office personnel? Why not the head office building? Why not the other asset in the head office, for example, furniture, IT equipments, motor vehicles? So why they limited themselves to the extent of salaries? Why not to other components of head office? So if this concept of charging salaries, building depreciation, IT equipments, it will continue, then there will be a problem. Unit will also cross charge to the head office. Again, head office will charge to unit, and it will be a never ending process. So definitely this service portion to the distinct person should be excluded from the schedule one.
So I just want to make one point, Deepak, on this. So you know, while we are supplying products from one state to another, we are already paying GST, and you know, now you are asking to cross charge or do ISD. So I have to and the cost of all those you know, cross charges and ISDs are already built up in my product.
Right.
Then
right.
How come, you know, I'm asked to pay double tax or transfer double GST to the recipient state? So I think it's whole illogical and just giving some kind of a donkey job to the industry to do, actually, you know, which is, you know, kind of useless, because everything is built up in the product. Then, you know, you do cross charge, then reduce the price of the product. You know, it's going to be a mathematics which keep up continuing without yielding any result to anyone, except, you know, putting some extra manpower and midnight oil. And maybe some food for, you know, kind of thought to the auditor who come in to kind of look at what you have done on ISD, year end, and cross charge. It doesn't make any sense to my mind. So your comment, Puneet.
And also it is a tax neutral, because if corporate is issuing a tax invoice, then other party is getting a tax benefit. So unnecessary, it is creating an issue and making the things very complex for the companies. And even cash flow issues as well are involved in this.
And Deepak, also there is a provision in valuation rule itself that if opposite party is registered party, and if they purchase goods for further sale, so whatever valuation you declare on the invoice, so it will be the market value.
Right.
So again, Madhav, it will demean the concept of cross charge or valuation. So there should be no logic in cross charging the head office services.
Actually, very, very valid points at one. Rahul, you have given a new perspective that as far as the value on which tax is paid, that already factors in. So it actually amounts to double taxation. And secondly, Sudhir and Raviji also pointed out that it's totally tax neutral. The other recipient location is entitled for credit. So why enter into all these disputes? Very, very valid. Yeah.
Right. So I think the pain of everyone is coming out in this issue, that they are facing so much difficulty and disputes in this, that everyone wishes that this should be made optional. And another point stated by the panelists is also very valid for the viewers, that they are in utter confusion of whether to include that employee cost or not. So I think these points are valid, but I think the end conclusion is that a clarification from the government only might help in this regard, that so that concrete steps can be taken by taxpayers.
Deepak, is my one point I would also like to add regarding this employee cost. So employee cost is neither a supply of goods nor a supply of services, right? So the explanation that employees are pertaining only to the one registration from their from which they have the payroll. So this interpretation may not be correct.
Right.
So if company employs an employee, if a company hires an employee, they did not hire an employee for only one registration. They hire employee for a complete, for a whole company, right? So this question is valid in case of related parties, but in case of distinct person, this question doesn't remain valid.
Right.
Very, very valid point.
Gupta,
I think in paucity, because of paucity of time, we can move to the next topic.
Sure.
I think we can spend 1 hour on this only.
right. So the next topic here is on implication on discounts and incentives. So this topic is also something which is faced by all the industries, be it auto, be it pharma, be it FMCG. So what happens is OEM, when they sell the goods to distributors, they issue all type of discounts. There may be wholesale discount, there may be retail discounts, there may be cash discounts, there may be discounts that whatever quantity is being by dealers to distributors, discount on that. So there are different type of discounts which are agreed. And OEMs, initially there was an option of issuance of GST credit note in this case, that whatever GST has been paid in excess, you can adjust it But that was conditional in nature. That had two conditions. The first condition is that discount should have been agreed at the time of supply and dealers should have reversed the ITC. Department practically is raising a lot of inspection or doing a lot of inspection in this regard that whether companies have satisfied this criteria or not. So I'd like to invite Rahul on Rahul's comment on this, because I think Rahul, on pharma industry per se, there are a lot of discounts which are offered. So what is your view? How is the industry dealing with this? Are they able to satisfy that these conditions are satisfied? Are they probably planning to move to non-GST credit note, or what's the industry's take on this?
Yeah, so thanks Deepak for this question. So, in pharma, while the market is very much regulated, so to say, and all these pricing as times is also regulated, and all our marketing structures and margins for the channel has already kind of fixed, and most of our 1+1 kind of a scheme or 10+2 kind of schemes are already kind of pre-decided, so to say. And, like we have a typical case of hospital business wherein, even the same distributor, when he sells to hospital, there are some different pricing structure vis-a-vis, to a normal channel. So all those, pricing and all that is, pre-decided, so to say. And, whenever, we get an evidence from the channel that they have supplied to the particular channel, and based on that pricing, for that particular channel, the credit note is issued to the person, which is effectively a reduction in the price, as per law. And those credit notes, in fact, if they are emanating from my side and I'm issuing those credit notes, then I could always reverse the credit, with the corresponding invoices. Then effectively what the customer have is only the limited amount of GST, it is available for them to take credit. And there has been, some discussion in pharma industry and a lot of investigation happened. And among all the pharma players, these are kind of policies, practically followed, and effectively, the onus on, reversing the credit, passes on to the customer. But if he takes any credit which is not appearing in my GST or one, and effectively is, kind of contravening the law, not, the supplier. Hmm. So that has been kind of tested in, audits as well, and, came out very good practice. And on top of it, when asked upon whether the customer is reversing credit or not, we have also checked with many of them, and they are actually reversing, because they cannot take anything more than what is there on the GST one of the company. Mm-hmm. And besides that, the circular which came in March of 19, so I was quite instrumental in kind of getting that issued for 1+1 kind of thing, plus the value credit note which got clarified there.
Mm-hmm.
For all those things which are which is not in the routine and which has come by way of a occasional discount or secondary discount, so they're largely handled by way of a value credit note, like expiries and all, where there's no implication of GST. All those are done on the value credit note, and that I think circular of a great help there, which I issued in March of 19.
So Deepak, even this issue, I think the government has actually made too complex. Mm-hmm. And these multiple circulars issued, Rahul is great, and I think you other industry players were finally able to get proper circular issued, because I could find even four dimensions of this discount issue also, which got arose because of these circulars. Firstly, as Rahul mentioned, whether discount is deductible or not, it is pre-known whether customer is reversing credit. The second issue which comes up is, which has been raised even in GST regime and past, especially for automotive dealers or FMCG dealers, that it qualifies as a service. They are agreeing to tolerate an act. Third issue, whether the dealers will be entitled for full credit because they have not paid full consideration. And fourth issue, which they added, that it constitutes as an additional consideration for the dealer. So at least the third and fourth issue were, they didn't issue proper clarification, but yeah, they withdrew the adverse circular. But yeah, whether it qualifies as a service or not, it continues to be debated, even though recently there's a favorable Madras High Court ruling. And this satisfaction of conditions of pre-agreed and ITC reversal at customers, we are seeing for large consumer companies that It's too complex in this system if because the authorities are investigating to get that data and to prove that yes, for each and every discount for which a deduction is claimed, it was pre-communicated to all the dealers. They have actually reversed the credit. So department is asking discount-wise, dealer-wise details for allowing the deduction.
Yeah. Right. So Puneet, two very important points which you raised, and one of the point as you mentioned is specific to auto industry. So I'd like Mr. Gupta to answer on this. Firstly, sir, number one, do you also face such issues that the department asking on, let us say, discount-wise detail of whether you are able to prove the auto industry in general? And second issue which Puneet mentioned is that they are reaching out to distributors and dealers to ask that the discounts received by them is qualifies as service. Specifically under service tax, we have seen a lot of show cause notice being issued to auto dealers. So do you foresee this issue to continue under GST or not? So what's your take on these two points, sir?
So, yeah, I think thanks, Deepak. And I think, I agree with Rahul's view on this. So I see the whole issue in two or three, pieces. One, I see this, the whole thing as more importantly, it is a discipline item. Yeah. So it calls for certain protocols. It calls for certain discipline. It calls for certain, principle to be followed while, sharing the discounts or other schemes with your channel partners. That's this. I see a problem to the disorganized sector, where these things are being used interchangeably as per convenience, I think, which is not the case neither to any of us sitting over here. Everybody is from the organized sector. Thirdly, on your question, a specific question that whatever the problems was there in the pre-GST era and the similar kind of issues will pop up. Definitely, I am very confident the issues will pop up because I see, GST in a different kind of a ball game. 29 states or maybe union territories, etc. Try it will be much more than that. Then there is a center, then there is a state department. So any issue, if any state will be raised by any of the authority because of any reason, definitely it will be replicated in other states as well to the other people as well. So the moment GST, things will start up. So we cannot be, so confident and so comfortable that, nothing will happen. Yeah, definitely three or four things, much more discipline is required. Much more organized policies are required. The intention of the department is to tap the leakage, the way discounts happens in the pre-GST regime. I think somewhat it is disciplined in this particularly era. So we cannot say that nothing will happen on the other side of the table. Everything will happen, but for the doing of each of business, I think department should come up with a simplified procedures. Whether it is a GST credit note or it is a commercial credit note, so long as it is revenue neutral, it is not impacting. And for the each of their own settlement within the state, the burden should not be imposed on the state. Industry to follow it.
Right.
So that would be my view, take on this. It would be a lot of things when, GST audits will start. I think the things with more clarity and more approach, clarity will come when GST audit will start, and then what kind of, show cause notices are raised. I think those are the things when some more clarity will come. But clearly I see the threat. I see the, the challenges looking forward on these issues.
So very valid point, sir. I think discipline vis-a-vis the companies is very important, that they make these checks and then they verify also that these checks are being followed or not by the teams. So Raviji, I think we have this privilege of having different industry players. So in your industry also, sir, how do you see this discount issue? Because I think it is spread across industry. It would be there in your industry also. So is industry issuing GST credit note, and how do they manage or how do they ensure that the recipients have reverse ITC?
Deepak, if you see this, most of the FMCG industries are working on MRP model. So discount is the lifeline of pricing of any FMCG industry.
Mm-hmm.
So various types of discounts are prevailing in our industry. We are offering this primary discount in the form of trade discount, where we are charging discount on the face of invoice. We are also offering these quantity discount, which is 1+1 kind of scheme. We are also offering early payment discount to our distributors. And apart from this discount, we are also having this loyalty point scheme, where the end customer purchased the goods and he got some point. And on accumulation of these points, he can go straight to the retailer and he can redeem those points against the final product. And apart from all these things, we also have target-based incentive to our distributors. These incentives are in the form of kind, basically which we are providing to them at the end of the specified period. So all kind of discounts are prevailing in FMCG industry.
And with the number of discounts would come the number of complexities also.
Yeah, you are right. So if I say if it is a matter of primary discount, so again, there is no question of deduction of the same from the assessable value because it itself is coming on the invoice. So when it is coming to the early payment discount or any subsequent discount, but in those cases, we have taken the approach to issue commercial credit note. So, and there is one more category which is not of discount. I think Mr. Rahul can also throw some light on that. That is basically a credit note to the customer on in the cases of damage and expired goods. So this is again a problem area for FMCG as well as pharmaceutical industry.
Right.
And in our industry, since our products are falling under highest rate of tax. So this problem is again a serious problem for us.
Right. True.
Yeah.
You are right. I think that is a big cost of GST being built up on expiries and restrictions.
Yeah.
So Deepak, as I think concluding remarks on this topic, the last point which Raviji and Rahul mentioned is that this expired and returns, etc., there needs to be clear guidelines or clarification from the government on various aspects on ITC reversal, etc. And secondly, even on the point whether when a company gives discount to a distributor or dealer, whether it qualifies as service or not. So when this last circular was issued, another circular was planned to be issued on the point that it does not qualify as a service. It was again discussed in GST Council meeting, and it is still placed on the draft circular on GST Council website to be issued. So had the government issued, or if it issues in near future, so even that it does not qualify as service, even that point will get addressed.
Right. I think the SSEs would have to start taking draft circulars before the authorities rather than the final circulars.
Right.
So moving on to the next issue, another important issue and the last issue for the day would be on place of supply. So place of supply issues are actually another issues which hamper the industry in the context that they are two diagonally opposite concepts under GST. One is the free flow of ITC, which is there. And the second is that destination-based tax. And how they have been married under GST is that in case of place of supply, they have specified certain provisions wherein they have stated that the place of supply would be a particular thing, even if irrespective if made to a registered dealer. So for audience sake, let us take a simple example. Let us say of a hotel service. So any company, let us say it is registered in Haryana and it goes to Maharashtra and a stay of hotel service is taken. In that case, the hotel would charge CGST and SGST. And because the taxes pertain to Maharashtra, the Haryana company would not be eligible to get that ITC. Therefore, it is becoming very important for the companies to determine the correct place of supply. Another important point here is that while the CGST, let us say the hotel mistakenly charged IGST on this supply instead of CGST and SGST, they would have then, the department would come to them. They would not refund IGST because the ITC might have been taken by the recipient, and they again demand CGST and SGST from that supplier. So incorrect determination of place of supply might actually lead to a double taxation vis-a-vis the supplier. One of a very important issue which is there is development of sale of tools, which I think again would attract mainly auto industry, or in fact even railway industry, or similar industry, that if the tools are being developed by the part manufacturer and they are sold to the recipient, but movement is not there. In that case, section 101C comes into place. And under 101C also, while there is no clarification issued from the department, a school of thought advocates that in that case, the supply should be local, even though the recipient is located outside the state. So in that case, my question firstly to Mr. H.P. Gupta would be, the auto industry, how are the vendors dealing with this issue? Are they, number one, well versed with the issue? Number two, are they taking this into cognizance, or how are they planning around this issue in this regard?
I think it's a very important and, you know, hot issue in automobile industry. And if I just, you know, take the stock of 4 years journey of GST, starting from 1st July 2017, different industries were approaching different practices over the period of time.
Hmm.
Somehow it seems that from last 1 year or so, industry has got onto a common platform where they kind of have it taking the unified approach to come up with this, again, a controversial issue. I think first of all, what we do and what, you know, we follow that practice, I will definitely cover that part also, but definitely department should come up with a very clear cut kind of, you know, ease of doing business for the purpose, because there is hardly anything which is related to revenue in this. It is in hardship, purely it is a hardship on the industry.
Right.
And it is more prevalent where your transaction is interstate. If it be an intrastate transaction, then there is no issue. Whether you, the transportation of the goods is happening or not. You are charging SGST, CGST, and then, you know, everything gets settled down and then you are eligible. But most of the, again, I would say the organized industry is just to avoid any future litigation, et cetera, they are, you know, getting the goods transported to other state first, and then, you know, taking the claim of ITC, and then, you know, sending back to that state for the purpose of making the components or the other parts of it. So while, you know, doing this thing, it serves both the things, domestic industry as well as the nuances of the export business as well. So definitely transportation of goods sometimes takes 3 days, 4 days, 5 days, and definitely it is an add-on cost to the industry. So I think government should come up with some provisions in the law which eases out such kind of the things. But by and large, you know, industry is, you know, believing in transportation of the goods and having the proper documentation. Maybe it is 10 days late, 15 days late, or it is cost, costing to them. But to avoid any future litigation, we are approaching that practice.
Right. I think the viewers would agree, sir, that there are different practices prevalent in the state, but one thing they'll agree that this should not be the case that the industry has to transport only for taxation purpose. There should be genuine reasons behind that. So that I think all the viewers would agree.
Yeah.
Right. So Sudhir, you would like to add anything on this, Sudhirji? How is the industry dealing with it, or how, what do you think the steps the government should be taking in this regard?
So yes, there is a big issue of the movement of goods for charging of the GST. And in my view, I'll just give you my view that since tool is being manufactured at a one location within the same premises, and it is being then shifted to a production area, then it should also be considered as a movement, and people should allow to charge IGST as well on these transactions. So my view is that because it can't happen that on the tool area or tool manufacturing area, the same tool is being used for manufacturing of the products. It is actually moving.
Right.
So that should be the way that it should be taken care. And it is a procedural issue only. Government doesn't want to have any tax benefit or tax revenue out of these transactions. So it should be taken care in that way that this will be considered as a movement and IGST should be allowed to charge on these transactions.
And Deepak, a related point is that like a determination of place of supply in a X Works sales. So if I am located in state A and I sell on a X Works basis to a customer in state B, ownership is getting transferred in state A and say customer comes and takes the goods to another state, whether it will be local or interstate. If we go by overall concept of GST being destination-based tax, etc., because eventually goods are moving to state B, therefore it should be IGST. But the way the law is worded, it should be a local sale only. And again, we have contrary rulings, etc. So be the ex works sale point I am making or the ground level issues, which Gupta ji or Sudhir is highlighting, that we have to do unnecessary transportation of goods in a tax neutral situation like this. So right. Government should come out with better will be an amendment in law so that even if the goods are not moving, ITC should be available.
I agree, Puneet. In the case of exorcities, there was an FAQ, but on this tools issue, there is absolutely no clarity. And the worst part is that the government is promoting Atmanirbhar Bharat. They are inviting everyone, foreign companies, Indian companies to manufacture more and more. And then these issues pertain, which are very basic issues to the manufacturing sector. Another issue, I think, which relates to, I'll say, Atmanirbhar or development of India is R&D activity, which is undertaken. So Rahul would agree that, let us say the R&D services are undertaken in India for a foreign customer. There's a lot of dispute that if, let us say, a raw material or a product on which that research is to be undertaken is received from outside India. There are disputes and negative advance rulings also suggesting that the service does not qualify as exporter service. On the other hand, if you see the GST Council meeting minutes, again, the discussions therein, if you see the service tax judgments, they all indicate that the goods are actually consumed. So they are not goods on which services are provided, but those are services are actually exported out of India because the goods, because the final facility move out of India. So Rahul, in your industry also, being a pharma industry, being such a research-centric industry, and research must be undertaken for foreign customers also. So what is your take? How is industry proceeding with it? Are they planning to pay GST on this? Are they planning to dispute it basis the erstwhile judgment? Or are they taking a different approach to it?
Thanks, Deepak, for this question. So, you know, if I would like to say, you know, there's many representation happened on this particular aspect, you know, for services given by Indian R&D companies or clinical trial companies to exclude, you know, few of those services from the ambit of, you know, the place of supply being the, you know, where the performance of the work is done. To a recipient-based service. You know, in fact, you know, government has also come up with a circular in September of 19, wherein they had, you know, charted out some 8 to 10 activity wherein, you know, the exemption is given. But surprisingly, you know, still there are a plethora of activities which are still not covered in the circular and the tax obligation. And just imagine, you have got your customer sitting in somewhere in Europe and they're asking to do some kind of testing and analytical work. And, you know, he has to also pay, you know, GST on that. And most of the customer, you know, they don't pay. And it actually builds up in our cost structures. So it is actually becoming counterproductive. And, you know, and many times we say the government has no right to levy tax on exports. So, you know, it is, you know, kind of impinging on all the aspects, so to say. And effectively kind of making India as not such a lucrative destination when it comes to these kind of services like analytical testing and stuff like that. So I think the kind of September 19 circular that they're given for conditional exemption, it has to be a pure play, you know, unconditional exemption for all the industry. so to say, not just pharma, but all other industry wherein all those kind of testing work could be done. I think like pharma being a complicated industry, other industries are also kind of, you know, take shape. We have a lot of these facility for testing and medical work could house in India because of, you know, availability of skilled manpower and even the technical space.
So Deepak, I think we can wind up our session and Deepak, you're on mute.
Right, sorry, yes.
So last, yeah, please Deepak. Yeah.
Right, so I think the last part is road ahead. So we'll request one suggestion from each panelist of what would they suggest, you can say, a change that would bring a lot of ease for the attendees, for the industry at large. So I think we can start with Raviji. You can firstly share of what one change which you will have, or one suggestion which you will give to the industry at large, that this change would actually this change would help them, or a suggestion to the government probably.
Deepak, my suggestion is actually, if you see in last 4 years, there are so many notifications, circulars, High Court at this Supreme Court rulings. So it is very difficult for us, for as an industry, maybe for you also in some cases, it's very difficult for us to chase all these notification rules, circular, et cetera, et cetera. And more of, on top of this, there are circulars and judgments which are contradictory of nature.
Hmm.
Right. So at least government should come up with all these clarification where there is a contradiction. Government can club all the circulars on a single issue. Government can club all the clarification in one single revised act, so that it will be a great help to the industry, because sitting here in a one single company, it's very difficult for us to recollect all the notifications, circulars, High Court judgment, Supreme Court judgments. So this is my suggestion to the government.
My suggestion that in case of any new circular or guidelines or Supreme Court ruling, even advanced ruling is coming up, then either it should be made prospective, and in case it is being made retrospective, then if an SSC is ready to do that rectification, then he should be allowed to do that, because these clarification has come because of there is an ambiguity in the law. And there are two views on the same. So assessee should be allowed to rectify the same without any interest and penalty. And if there is any GST implication, then the recipient should be allowed to take an input on the same. It should not be like disallowed because just because there is an ambiguity and the resolution has come with retrospective effect. So my view is either the prospective, or if it retrospective, then there should not be any loss to any of the SSE. In case that it is not an intentional issue. If it is an intentional issue, that I agree that it's a breach of a trust, then it should be penalized, but not in the genuine cases.
Valid point, sir. I think all these judgments, unsettling the classification, the taxpayers don't mind the tax cost, but the interest cost becomes a lot of burden for them.
Right. And also that input should be allowed to the ultimate customer.
Right.
It should not happen that they should issue the GSTN, but customer is not able to take the input credit. Then again, it's a loss.
Right. Gupta, sir, your suggestion?
Largely, I agree with Sudhir's view. First of all, it should be prospectively. Only one point I would like to supplement to his thoughts, that advance rulings should and has been made in the system for the ease of doing business and for resolving the issue. Of late, it is appearing that it is creating the complexity in the system. So I think that battle has to be settled out. If 29 states will give their 29 advance ruling, I think things will never settle out. Once we call it one state, one tax, one nation, so many jargons we use, So that again, you know, I would be very strongly urging that it should be one advance ruling forum. Maybe different authorities could be there, different structure could be there, but it should be one which should be unifiedly followed by everyone. And it should be for the better tax positions and better, you know, administration of the tax rather than, you know, creating so many hassles around. Yeah, that's my suggestion.
True, so true. In fact, in our yesterday seminar, when we were reflecting 4 years of GST, this point came again and again, that advanced rulings, as you have rightly also mentioned, that they are creating more confusions than settling the issue. Rahulji, you would like to add your suggestion?
Yeah, thanks, Deepak. So I just want to make my point is to make that GST a good or simple tax, and let's look at what are provisions which are actually creating impediment in doing business or just an administrative burden on the industry. So like we have discussed on ISD and cross charge, we have discussed on this intermediary service stuff and something like R&D, testing analytic service and stuff like that. So they have to look at all these points and just do that work with proper analytics and open mind and kind of ease out the burden, because nobody in the government side would want the litigation and kind of administrative burden on the industry. Whatever administrative bandwidth would be kind of get freed from the industry, they could probably invest time in growing the business rather than doing something which is just not adding to any value to any aspect of the life of the industries.
Right.
So if we have to summarize everyone's suggestion, they want it to be a simple tax. So let's hope government also listens to all these representations and pleas and actually implement that.
Question, Puneet. I am also itching to ask Mr. Gupta if he'll be kind enough to answer. I hope, sir, you don't mind the opportunity of me asking here. So basically, I think many of the viewers would also be like to know the view of the OE sector. So let us say after Westinghouse, the department proceeds them, they, for any reason, they decide to pay this amount. What would be the concerns from the OE side that whether they'll be able to reimburse this amount to the vendors or they'll have some concerns around that?
I think you have put me in a catch-22 situation. So let me try to reply. Rather, I would say let me make an attempt to answer your question. See, first of all, supply chain partners are very close associate of any OEM. Yeah, and it is not. I'm going on a different tangent for a few seconds. It is not like that. Like the service providers, it is not our mercy to pick and choose. Yeah. So once they are associated for a long time. And if we wanted to even create an alternate, it will take few years to create an alternate. So they are part and parcel of the family. They are part and parcel of the complete business chain. That's number one. I think that has to be kept in mind. Number one. Number two, having said that, let me try to give the flip side of it. It also depends how strong your agreement is, with the various supply chain partners. What does that talk about? Such kind of nitty-gritties has been discussed there or not. You have a supplier dealer agreement or supplier agreement with the OEM on both the fronts we have, whether it is back end or front end. So largely, it will be governed by, with the logic of what the agreement says. And big organization would not be in a position to take the unilateral view discriminating view for supplier to supplier. So whatever I would say, the trend will emerge. It would be kind of, unified. It would be kind of adopted by everyone. And I see still a lot of time is there when some calls will be taken around this key, whether how to deal with. I think still there is sufficient time available. So I think in the time to come, but yeah, if one industry will start, others will follow. It will be kind of a first mover or, one thing I'm sure with the kind of setup of, nowadays, regulatory authorities are there, or role of the independent directors are there. It will not be easy to industry for to follow, you know, pick and choose kind of a concept. It would be very, very homogeneous, and it would be very, very logical and rational across, you know, the complete spectrum of supply chain partners. That would be my.
So with this, we come to the end of the session, and thanks once again to Gupta ji, Ravi ji, Rahul, Sudhir for taking time for this session. And your thoughts were indeed valuable and practical as well. So with this, we wind up, and we'll come back again tomorrow with our third session.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Puneet,
for giving us an opportunity.
Thank you, Puneet. Thank you, Deepak.
Very wonderful.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you all.